Random House Audio presents 1493, Uncovering the New World Columbus Created, by Charles C. Mann, read for you by Robertson Dean. Prologue. Like other books, this one began in a garden. Almost 20 years ago, I came across a newspaper notice about some local college students who had grown 100 different varieties of tomato. Visitors were welcome to take a look at their work. Because I like tomatoes, I decided to drop by with my 8-year-old son. When we arrived at the school's greenhouse, I was amazed. I'd never seen tomatoes in so many different sizes, shapes, and colors. A student offered us samples on a plastic plate. Among them was an alarmingly lumpy specimen, the color of an old brick, with a broad green-black tonsure about the stem. Occasionally, I have dreams in which I experience a sensation so intensely that I wake up. This tomato was like that. It jolted my mouth awake. Its name, the student said, was Black from Tula. It was an heirloom tomato developed in 19th century Ukraine. I thought tomatoes came from Mexico, I said, surprised. What are they doing breeding them in Ukraine? The student gave me a catalog of heirloom seeds for tomatoes, chili peppers, and beans, common beans, not green beans. After I went home, I flipped through the pages. All three crops originated in the Americas, but time and again the varieties in the catalog came from overseas: Japanese tomatoes, Italian peppers, Congolese beans. Wanting to have more of those strange but tasty tomatoes, I went on to order seeds, sprout them in plastic containers, and stick the seedlings in a garden, something I'd never done before. Not long after my trip to the greenhouse, I visited the library. I discovered that my question to the student had been off the mark. To begin, tomatoes probably originated not in Mexico, but in the Andes Mountains. Half a dozen wild tomato species exist in Peru and Ecuador, all but one inedible, producing fruit the size of a thumbtack. And to botanists, the real mystery is less how tomatoes ended up in Ukraine or Japan than how the progenitors of today's tomato journeyed from South America to Mexico, where native plant breeders radically transformed the fruits, making them bigger, redder, and most important, more edible. Why transport useless wild tomatoes for thousands of miles? Why had the species not been domesticated in its home range? How had people in Mexico gone about changing the plant to their needs? These questions touched on a long-standing interest of mine, the original inhabitants of the Americas. As a reporter in the news division of the journal Science, I had from time to time spoken with archaeologists, anthropologists, and geographers about their increasing recognition of the size and sophistication of long-ago native societies. The botanists' puzzled respect for Indian plant breeders fit nicely into that picture. Eventually, I learned enough from these conversations that I wrote a book about researchers' current views of the history of the Americas before Columbus. The tomatoes in my garden carried a little of that history in their DNA. They also carried some of the history after Columbus. Beginning in the 16th century, Europeans carried tomatoes around the world. After convincing themselves that the strange fruits were not poisonous, farmers planted them from Africa to Asia. In a small way, the plant had a cultural impact everywhere it moved, sometimes not so small. One can scarcely imagine southern Italy without tomato sauce. Still, I didn't grasp that such biological transplants might have played a role beyond the dinner plate until, in a used bookstore, I came across a paperback, Ecological Imperialism by Alfred W. Crosby, a geographer and historian then at the University of Texas. Wondering what the title could refer to, I picked up the book. The first sentence seemed to jump off the page. European emigrants and their descendants are all over the place, which requires explanation. I understood exactly what Crosby was getting at. Most Africans live in Africa, most Asians in Asia, and most Native Americans in the Americas. People of European descent, by contrast, are thick on the ground in Australia, the Americas, and Southern Africa. Successful transplants, they form the majority in many of those places, an obvious fact, but one I had never really thought about before. Now I wondered, why is that the case? Ecologically speaking, it is just as much a puzzle as tomatoes in Ukraine. Before Crosby and some of his colleagues looked into the matter, historians tended to explain Europe's spread across the globe almost entirely in terms of European superiority, social or scientific. Crosby proposed another explanation in Ecological Imperialism. Europe frequently had better trained troops and more advanced weaponry than its adversaries, he agreed, but in the long run, its critical advantage was biological, not technological. The ships that sailed across the Atlantic carried not only human beings, but plants and animals, sometimes intentionally, sometimes accidentally. After Columbus, ecosystems that had been separate for eons suddenly met and mixed in a process Crosby called, as he had titled his previous book, the Columbian Exchange. The exchange took corn, maize, to Africa, and sweet potatoes to East Asia, horses and apples to the Americas, and rhubarb and eucalyptus to Europe, and also swapped about a host of less familiar organisms like insects, grasses, bacteria, and viruses. The Columbian Exchange was neither fully controlled nor understood by its participants, but it allowed Europeans to transform much of the Americas, Asia, and to a lesser extent Africa, into ecological versions of Europe, landscapes the foreigners could use more comfortably than could their original inhabitants. This ecological imperialism, Crosby argued, provided the British, French, Dutch, Portuguese, and Spanish with the consistent edge needed to win their empires. Crosby's books were constitutive documents in a new discipline, environmental history. The same period witnessed the rise of another discipline, Atlantic studies, which stressed the importance of interactions among the cultures bordering that ocean. Recently, a number of Atlanticists have added movements across the Pacific to their purview. The field may have to be renamed. Taken together, researchers in all these fields have been assembling what amounts to a new picture of the origins of our world-spanning, interconnected civilization, the way of life evoked by the term globalization. One way to summarize their efforts might be to say that to the history of kings and queens most of us learned as students has been added a recognition of the remarkable role of exchange, both ecological and economic. Another way might be to say that there is a growing recognition that Columbus's voyage did not mark the discovery of a new world, but its creation. How that world was created is the subject of this book. The research has been greatly aided by recently developed scientific tools. Satellites map out environmental changes wreaked by the huge, largely hidden trade in latex, the main ingredient in natural rubber. Geneticists use DNA assays to trace the ruinous path of potato blight. Ecologists employ mathematical simulations to simulate the spread of malaria in Europe, and so on. The examples are legion. Political changes, too, have helped. To cite one of special importance to this book, it is much easier to work in China nowadays than it was in the early 1980s when Crosby was researching ecological imperialism. Today, bureaucratic suspicion is minimal. The chief obstacle I faced during my visits to Beijing was the abominable traffic. Librarians and researchers there happily gave me early Chinese records, digital scans of the originals, which they let me copy onto a little memory stick that I carried in my shirt pocket. What happened after Columbus, this new research says, was nothing less than the forming of a single new world from the collision of two old worlds, three, if one counts Africa as separate from Eurasia. Born in the 16th century from European desires to join the thriving Asian trade sphere, the economic system for exchange ended up transforming the globe into a single ecological system by the 19th century, almost instantly in biological terms. The creation of this ecological system helped Europe seize, for several vital centuries, the political initiative, which in turn shaped the contours of today's world-spanning economic system in its interlaced, omnipresent, barely comprehended splendor. Ever since violent protests at a 1999 World Trade Organization meeting in Seattle brought the idea of globalization to the world's attention, pundits of every ideological stripe have barraged the public with articles, books, white papers, blog posts, and video documentaries attempting to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.